one time.
Mike, how many kids in the online classes right now?
One, the biggest one is 7. Yeah.
And this area here is really just used for the computer drafting. These computers, these can easily be set up in that Woods classroom along the wall. Set up the computers in there to do the computer drafting part. What's that about the desk? Not a lot different than here.
On the classroom.
Oh, in the classroom.
Yeah, not in the shop. And then this area, the metals classroom. We include this area.
Would this stay or not?
You know, I think eventually we'd take it out to start with. I don't know if it would or not. We just remove the door. You can still supervise the area. Ultimately, I think we want to remove the glass and that structure there. But the, you know, the square footage of this space here is virtually identical to what is out there now with all our equipment. In the space that had the weight equipment. So really to change this, we need to do something different with the floor. Rubberized flooring in.
Is there a drinking fountain out there? Or?
There is, right around the restrooms out there. And this, we have an exit here. So for summer use, this area can be cooled separately than the main system. It's not all hooked in with the main cooling system. So.
What about the vault ceiling and lights?
Some of this we'd have to move up just because of the nature of some of the exercises. You know, 75% can stay the way it is. There's room to move up in most areas. HVAC is tricky. The lights and the tiles.
A lot of rooms out. If we follow our history.
Yeah.
Where part of that used to be a paint booth, is there any exhaust system in the room?
I don't know.
Yeah. Where's all the stuff being moved in here?
All the stuff.
Is that an office?
Yeah, we've got two offices. We can walk through that for you. We've got a lot of stuff that some of it we may need to get rid of. But we have an office here. Over the years, have collected things that. What do we get rid of? What do we need to keep? Site council brought up, what if we consolidate with another school district? What happened then? And you know, what if we have 100 more kids here going to school? That would present a challenge. We may wish we had that space back, but we could have two teachers with the two offices and the classroom and the two shops. We could make it work even if we did have two teachers and not have that space. If you walk in through there, I'll walk around and unlock that. See the Woods classroom.
Mm-hmm.
just as long as I. And the same way with the camp shop.
$1,979?
You better. Well, no, that's what. It is when we go through.
So we would need to find a way to consolidate what we do in that metals classroom and what we do in here into one room. In the class, in, you know, computers along the wall or somewhere. So it's not easily done. We need to consolidate down, but get rid of some stuff and it's doable. Any questions on what we're talking about here?
How many kids do we have in our industrial arts?
29.
29. Mm-hmm.
How many classes does that involve?
6 classes.
Currently we have 1 weights class, and that was brought up by somebody in the site council that, you know, we're going to be using that space for 1 classroom, and that is true. I mean, but we use it other times too, before and after school and during the summer. And you know, if we had the staff, the kids want to take more, you know, weights classes or advanced PE classes. But right now, we don't have the staff to do that. We got 23 kids in weights now. It's a packed house in there. I don't think we can do with less room. 23 kids in there working out at the same time. So.
Any questions? Can we look at the weights for plan? Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Heats all day, every day. Really just to keep the space warm enough to use, but keep the plumbing from freezing. You know, we need to keep it at a reasonable temperature in here. If we would do away with this space for the weight room, the idea would be to put in some overhead doors along that wall, and we could park vehicles in here.
What would it cost to insulate this building? So you wouldn't have to use so much heat.
I don't know the answer to that.
A new building.
Oh, yeah.
A new building.
How many doors are you thinking?
Well, I'm 1 each day there. Thinking 5. To move on. I didn't figure lately, but $4,000 or $5,000 for flooring in there. You know, our guys can do the work. Provided we don't run into anything crazy with
HVAC system or anything like that.
I think it averages $300 a month. Year round average in here for this?
For heating, $2,000 a year.
$2,000 a year going this way.
I need to take caution because always felt this needed to be in my school somewhere.
Well, and as far as taking classroom, you know, every time when there's a Woods class, they're in the Woods classroom. The Meadows classroom is empty. And when there's a Meadows classroom, they're in there, but the Woods classroom is empty. And without two teachers, there's space sitting empty during the day.
Any other questions?
Is this action item?
Yeah. You gonna head back over to the boardroom?
Order. I'd like to welcome our visitor, Mrs. Cornwell. Mark Bauer.
Nice to be here.
Welcome. Carol. Any additions or changes to the agenda?
No.
Okay. And motion to approve the agenda.
Mr. President, I move we approve the agenda as presented.
Second. Moved and seconded to approve the agenda as presented. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carries 7-0. The consent agenda is there in front of you.
I have nothing unusual to report except the item E with the contingency reserve fund. There's an explanation in your packet there. Mark will cover that in his report briefly, but we need that to happen in case we have things come up here at the end of this budget year when we close out the books. It gives us authority to take care of those things from last budget year.
Is there a motion to approve?
Mr. President, I move the board approve the consent agenda as presented.
Second. Moved and seconded to approve the consent agenda as presented. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carried 7-0. Are there any patron comments tonight? All right. If not, we will open the budget hearing. Any public comments related to the amended budget published on April 29th? All right, we will now close the budget hearing. On to business items. Approve the amended budget.
Page 23 of the budget amendment form, page 24 and 25 on your supporting documents is the total budget. The only thing that's changed is general fund. So we can capture the additional state aid for higher enrollment is the only reason we're doing this. So it does not change our tax rate or anything like that. So.
Mr. President, I move the board approve the budget amendment as presented.
Second.
Moved and seconded to approve the budget amendment as presented. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carried 7-0. Mr. Bauer and financial audit.
First thing I'm going to do is kind of hand out some stuff. So. Well, I think if I just kind of start. And then we'll start it. There's a staple and then one that's not staple, just the front and the back. So if you take one of each. And then there should be an actual number here too, so you keep it in. I'll get yours. Mind if I just right here on the corner?
You bet.
Yeah, it should be one. It should be an extra one of the.
Okay.
Yeah. And is there an extra one of the letters?
It's still
coming around. Okay, still. I'll wait for those to come around.
You recall, we have a new auditing firm, Von Felt, Bauer and Von Felt, and Mark Bauer's been real good to work with, and I will...
Well, I appreciate it. I appreciate that.
Let him take over and do his thing.
Dad told me to keep it short, so...
No, that's the suggestion.
I know. Believe me, I've heard that a time or two, so... it is good to be here, and I know switching auditing firms is not an easy task, and I think coupled that with also switching accounting systems in the fiscal year is not easy too. So I guess before I forget, I want to say I do appreciate the patience that Josh, Julianne, and Marla showed me and my staff in terms of working with them, and we enjoyed working with them and look forward to working with you all in the future. I'm going to start with the separate sheets, the letters first. When we do an audit, we're required by auditing standards to review internal control. We don't issue an opinion on internal control, but we do evaluate the internal control practices of the district in order for us to establish what our auditing procedures will be. So the first letter, which is the single sheet, is our report, just a letter regarding if we become aware of any deficiencies that we perceive as deficiencies in the control environment, we're required to report that in writing. And again, you've received the same type of letter in the past. But a couple things when we go through that. We did note a couple items that we wanted to bring to your attention. I've talked with Josh and Julianne and Marla about these. But the first one deals with the processing of the payroll liabilities. And again, part of it, I think, is attributable to the switch in the accounting systems. The Aptifund, the new accounting system, handles things differently than the old system did. The old system was more of a single entry type of an accounting system, whereas the Apt is a full-fledged double entry accounting system. So it does take some getting used to. We've had a couple other districts switch, and there is a learning curve with it. So, and I think part of this maybe deals kind of is attributable, part of this condition is attributable to that. But in processing those liabilities, the payroll liabilities, when those are paid, are not being really separated in terms of being kind of grouped together in terms of total payroll liabilities. That makes it, when it's time to do the bank reconciliation and reconcile those, makes it difficult, if not impossible, to identify those individual checks that are making that up. So, you know, the practice in the past has been to just basically clear those and then carry that difference in terms of an adjustment or reconciling the account. But the problem with that is you kind of lose the detail of what makes that up, and as that's rolled forward, it becomes difficult to identify that. The combination of that and then with the new accounting system, the payroll liabilities that aren't paid, that remain on the books, those really need to be reconciled back to the books in terms of the liability balances, where again, in the old system, you know, basically the checks were cut right away and there weren't necessarily outstanding liabilities. And again, when we're talking about liabilities, we're talking about encumbrances, accounts payable, and liabilities. So that's kind of what's happening. And again, like I told Josh and Julianne and Marla, you know, what worked in the past with the old accounting system, you know, doesn't work quite as well with the new one. And again, I think even with the old one, we probably would have had the same recommendation that those be separated, the vendors be specifically identified, the categories as far as the payroll liabilities be identified, so that again, in the process of reconciling the bank statement, those can all be separated and segregated. And I think we've talked, Julianne and Marla, in the process of doing that and getting those separated. And that will make the whole process at your end, I think, much easier. In addition to that, and again, we've talked with them about the importance of then any remaining liabilities that aren't paid in terms of the vouchers in the system being reconciled back to the liability balances on the books. And again, that's something that I know is in process. Talked with Josh and again, Julianne on that, and you know, I would like to kind of work through that with them in terms of, where, you know, in 14-15, and again, I think in there we say that, you know, this recommendation is in the process of being implemented, and it's expected to be fully implemented by the end of the fiscal year. So again, I think the idea is for me to come back once school's out and make sure that that's all working. And again, so that we're all on the same page in terms of how that should work. The last part of that kind of deals with and leads into the next point. You know, once those reconciliations are performed, I think it's important that they do be reviewed and approved by someone, you know, independent of whoever is preparing them. And again, like the bank rec, in the way it's being done now, being prepared by Marla. Julianne, my thought would be preparing the payroll liability reconciliations. And again, I think it's important that someone other than those two review and approve it. That kind of leads into the second point, which is a point you've had in the past. And quite honestly, all of the districts I work with, all of the cities we work with are small, have the same kind of issue in terms of segregation of duties. You know, you just don't have enough people, and it's not like you have a large accounting department that where you can segregate all the functions in terms of the process that would what would be considered ideal. Okay. Now, that being said, there are things that you can do to help mitigate that condition. And again, I think you're doing that in terms of segregating as much as you can. This would be another deal. The review and monitoring process, I think, is very important in terms of, you know, helping to mitigate that condition. And again, that's why we recommend that someone other than the one preparing it review and approve it. And you know, Josh and I even talked about, you know, it could be something that could be included with the board packet or something. If you wanted to go that route, he could review it, approve it, and then include it with the board packet or something. Again, we can kind of work the details out on that as we go. Any questions on those two items? Okay. The kind of the staple page, that's what's called a letter to those charged with governance. The first one's kind of directed to the board and then the management. This one's kind of directed just specifically to those charged with governance. And again, it's a required communication. It doesn't necessarily have to be in writing. We always like to put it in writing just so, again, it's there and it's documented. But basically, we're required to report if we encountered any difficulties during the audit, if we had any disagreements with management, if there was a difference of opinion in the application of, you know, accounting principle. And again, you all use the regulatory basis of accounting, which is the same basis which you do your budgets on. We're required to report any of those things that might have happened in a letter to the governing body. And as you read through that, you'll notice that we didn't have any disagreements, we didn't have any differences of opinion, wasn't any disagreements in terms of how an application of an accounting principle should be handled. It talks in there about if management consulted with other accountants, if you know, they didn't agree with us, if they consulted with somebody else, we would have to note that, and again, we're not aware of that happening. From talking to Josh and Julianne, that didn't happen either. And that's all good. You know? Like I said, basically, we talked about things and worked through things. And again, this first year with APTA, you know, again, we've had two other districts that have switched. And anytime you switch, there's issues. And again, you know, we were able to work through those. So we also are required to report on there or to include in that the adjustments, and again, those are included there that were agreed to and corrected by. Again, went over this with Josh, Julianne, and Marlon, and those were all agreed to and approved and have been posted. The other thing that's presented there is what's called the client representation letter, and again, that's a 4 or 5 page letter that basically is just written representations, things that we ask, you know, both Josh, Julianne, and Marlon also. In terms of, you know, that they provided us with all the information, with all the records, and you know, answer our questions to the best of their knowledge and ability and all that. So that's a fairly, I think there's 30-some points or something that we go over on that. So that's presented there also. Okay. Any questions on that before we look at the actual audit? Okay, the actual audit report. On page 1 and 2 is our opinion. You know, the financial statements are your financial statements. You hire us to issue an opinion on whether or not they're fairly presented in all material respects. Again, I'm not going to go through the whole audit report in detail. It's in accordance with the regulatory basis, your budget document that you adopted in, you know, back in July and August, in terms of that, had the prior year balances, in terms of the 12-13, and then also the current balances, which was the middle column of the budget document, was the 13-14 column. But I do want to point out a few things. On page one, it talks about, there's a paragraph in there where halfway down, I guess three quarters of the way down the first page, it talks about a basis for adverse opinion on United States General Set of Accounting Principles. Remember, you all adopt a waiver each, you know, probably at the beginning of each year, your organizational meeting, you adopt what's called a gap waiver. That allows you, and again, it's allowed by the state, most municipalities, most school districts opt out of what's called generally accepted accounting principles, allows you to prepare your financial statements on the same basis of accounting as you prepare your budget. So when you're looking at the numbers, the rules in terms of how those numbers are derived are the same for the budget as they are for the financial statements. That's allowed when you adopt that waiver every year. All that this is saying is it's calling the reader's attention to the fact that, you know, that you have done that you're not using generally accepted accounting principles, that you are using what's considered another comprehensive accounting, in your case, the regulatory basis of accounting. So again, it's just calling the reader's attention, saying that, hey, they're not in accordance with generally accepted accounting principles, but they're not intended to be in accordance with generally accepted accounting principles. Okay? On the top of the next page is where we get into, and again, that's where it says, you know, adverse opinion, you know, it says that it's not in accordance, but again, remember, it's not intended to be in accordance. The paragraph below that, where it says opinion on the regulatory accounting, that's where we're talking about in terms of, you know, in our opinion, the financial statements aren't fairly presented in all material respects in accordance with the regulatory basis of accounting. Again, that's the statutory basis of accounting. Okay. That's what it used to be called. Now they call it the regulatory basis. But that's the same basis that you do your budget on. Any questions on that? Supplementary information, that's going to be the individual detailed schedules of the individual funds, and I'll show you where that is. But again, you know, we audited that as part of the audit financial statements, and given that our opinions are what we said. Any questions on that? Page 3 and 4 is the overview of the funds of the district. And this is the financial statement that's in accordance with the regulatory basis. Just shows all the funds of the district, the beginning unencumbered cash, receipts, expenditures, ending unencumbered cash. If you look at that ending unencumbered cash balance column, you kind of scan down that. You know, a negative balance there would indicate that maybe you have expended more funds than what you had available in any of the funds. That's, you know, would be considered a cash basis violation. And again, as you can see, scanning down that, all those funds are positive or zero. Now remember how general fund works. You know, the school finance formula, you know, basically you spend all the money you have available and you'll end up with a zero cash balance, unencumbered cash balance. And again, that's what that reflects. Okay, so again, that the supplemental general fund, you're always going to have some cash carryover. That's how you use to help budget next year. And Josh has built that into his, what would be his 14-15 budget, again, whatever's carried over. Again, you spent, you'll see, you spent your full supplemental general fund budget authority, but there's always going to be some cash carried over because of how you do the budget in terms of your estimating the collection percentage and delinquency. Okay? If we flip over to page 5, the notes to the financial statements, just a couple things to point out there. In the past, and also this year, you do include the Memorial Library in terms as part of the reporting entity. That's an option that municipalities have. If they have related municipal entities, you can include those in your financial statements instead of them having a separate financial statement on it. That's how you have done that. And that fund or those accounts are reflected in the financial statement. The note C is just a little bit of a description about the regulatory basis of accounting, some of the differences between that and general accepted accounting principles. Note 7, or on page 7, note 3, talks about compliance with Kansas statutes. And we didn't note any instances of non-compliance in terms of the financial operations of the district in terms of how, what you did in terms of complying with Kansas statutes to relate to that. So that's good. Talks about depository security, you know, we do test that. You're required by statutes to make sure that all your deposits are adequately secured, not only at June 30th, this note talks about it June 30th. We do test that for the entire year because, again, you know, you have different periods where you have larger deposits, larger funds on hand than others. So we test that during the year and make sure that in the district's deposits are adequately secured. 9 and 10 shows the debt of the district. And again, you paid off the bonds early. Got that finished up last year. So those are zero at the end of the year. And so the only thing that you have outstanding is the new lease purchase agreement. So that's reflected there. That's a 10-year deal. So the way we're, the disclosure requirement of that is to show the first 5 years individually and then in 5-year increments. So there's only one 5-year increment because that takes you to the end of that. So on page 13-14 shows compliance with the budget law. Again, takes the funds of the district and those are required to be budgeted and compares the budget, the actual expenditures to the budget expenditures. Again, when you look at that variance over or under, a positive would indicate that that you have exceeded your budget, that you would be over budget. Again, when you adopt that budget each year, just like you did your amended budget, you're setting the legal amount of expenditures that you can incur. Okay. So again, you're doing, when you adopt that budget, you're setting the mill levy necessary to fund the budget, but you're also setting the legal maximum of expenditures that you anticipate spending. Can't go over that unless you amend. And again, the reason you amended this one wasn't due to that, it was because of the state aid and because of the enrollment, which is good. It's good to have to amend for those reasons. But again, if you follow that column down, you'll notice all of those are either zero or negative, which would mean all funds are under budget. Remember the general fund. You know, again, it's going to be, if you don't spend it, then you lose the funding. So again, you can see there that except for 64 cents, which is just due to rounding, you spent your entire budget. That's how you got down to the zero cash balance. And again, that's where we talked about earlier about the supplemental general fund being budgeted out to zero. Again, you, even though you had cash left over, you had spent all your budget. And again, when we talk about spending, you're talking about making year-end transfers and replenishing your cash balances in your special revenue funds. The rest of the audit report is just the individual fund financial statements, but I'm not going to go through those in detail. I think that I'll quit at that point and kind of trying to keep in line with not talking too long because I have a tendency to do that. So I think I'll stop there and see if anybody has any questions. Again, we do appreciate being of service. Enjoy working with you know, Dr. Palma and Julian and looking forward to working with them in the future. And really, truly, I do appreciate their patience. Again, switching auditors and accounting systems is probably not on the... probably don't want to do that every year, so... but again, I look forward to working with them in the future and you in the future.
Any questions for Mr. Bauer?
Are there anything here that we're spending way more than other schools, or are we in line with everybody?
Nothing really popped out. Josh and I kind of went through some of the funds, and you know, in terms of you know just how you are sitting, you know, budget-wise in terms of carryovers and that. And again, you know, I think if you go through there and you compare your balances from what you started the year with to what you ended the year with, you'll notice that most of the funds were you were able to replenish those back to where you started. And again, Josh and I talked a little bit about that. We didn't get into a lot of budget planning, but you know, I think he and I both are in agreement in terms of some goals. I think he shared some goals with you in terms of, you know, cash balances and what would be, you know, desirable. And again, I know in light of the current school grants, desirable and attainable are in two different things sometimes.
Would you say that we are flush with cash?
I would say no. Okay. I would say no. Yeah. And if you want to go through, I mean, I'll go through those with you and kind of show you in terms of that. Now, again, that doesn't, I'm not saying that, you know, you're in dire straits either, you know. But again, I think that in terms of what Josh shared with me, that he shared with you in terms of cash balances and some of the special revenue funds in terms of building those up. You know, like food service, trying to get that, if possible, to the maximum, which is only 3 months of expenditures, an average of 3 months expenditures. Mm-hmm. You know, again, some of the funds that you're, you know, special education, I think, is another thing mm-hmm. Josh and I look at in terms of, you know, ideally, if you could work that up to where you would be able to carry over your assessment, you know, and again, I think right now you're, you know, significantly lower than what your annual assessment. The reason that those are important is because if you run into a situation where, you know, if something happens and you don't have the money available to transfer, you know, if you don't have the reserve in there, you don't have the flexibility to kind of back off on some of those transfers. So again, what's desirable in that, you know, again, it's one of those things I think you just have to be, and again, in light of the current environment, you know, you can't be overly, or you can't be too cautious in terms of that. So, is that the answer?
Sure, yeah.
So, and again, I'd be happy to, you know, sit down and go through individual funds. You know, from talking with Josh, he's got a very good handle on the budget process. And, you know, like I said, he and I kind of went through some of those funds. I think we were in agreement in terms of, you know, what he's shown you in terms of what he would like to, you know, see in terms of, and again, it's tough, you know, it's tough in light of the current school finance situation. And again,
I got a question.
Mm-hmm.
On the news here last week or so, the state came out and gave some emergency funds to a few school districts.
Mm-hmm.
Right. What is the difference between those? How did they get in the situation they are? To need this money because an air conditioner quit that they didn't have it compared to those school districts that have that money mm-hmm. available or, you know, some way of financing it or something that, you know, they're needing to close early because they don't have enough money. What's the difference right. between districts?
I'm not familiar with the
I can speak to Pratt Skyline. They,
I wasn't going to name their names, but
as they had roughly $100,000 in cash carryover in their local option budget, and they lost more than that in state aid this year than what had been planned for. So they set their budget, set their mill levy, and now they're not going to get that money they expected from the state, and that was more. A cut was more than they had in
they
cash.
Were one of those that got
That local option budget deal, you know, I mean, the state aid did get cut on that. And so if you were a high state aid district, in terms of that, you know, what happens is, you know, you plan when you set your budget and you set your mill levy, you anticipated having that state aid. Now that it's been cut, again, I'm not familiar with their situation, but they probably didn't have enough cash to spend their local option budget for the year.
Yeah. And they had set their budget and planned on those
right.
things. The other school districts, I don't know.
Yeah.
What
the other time that happens is we see that, I've seen that happen with oil and gas valuation, where, you know, you set your budget based on prior year's oil and gas valuation and the estimates for the county, and then you get significant protests, and, if you've budgeted and you know that tax money doesn't come in, you know I have seen some districts run short in terms of the tax levy because the you know what they thought they were going to get in terms of the valuation, in terms of the collection percentage and delinquency, ended up being nowhere near what they ended up getting. Now, some of them eventually got some of that in terms of down the road in delinquent taxes, but for the current year that can be significant. And again, that's tough when you know. You're budgeting based upon those estimates, and you know. And again, I think that's why it's important to build that cushion in. It's why it's important to have some cash reserves to carry over. And Again, just gives you a little bit of cushion in case something like that comes up that you really don't have any control of. So, good questions.
Well, that's the mindset of Mr. Meyer and the board to build that.
Absolutely. And I think that's, again, you know, I think if the funding, and again, I've been doing this for 30 years, so, and the last 5 to 10 years, you know, it's just year to year. You just don't know. And a lot of times you don't know, like that, you know, you didn't know that was going to happen until you were halfway through the year. You set your contracts, you got your teachers hired, you basically committed to your attendance centers. I mean, you spent, you know, 2/3 of your budget. Again, you haven't paid for it yet, but I mean, you've committed. And then to have that happen, again, that happened a few years ago when the Bay State Aid for People got cut, you know, towards the end of the year. And again, I think if the funding mechanism is more stable, and I do believe that's the intent of the block grant deal, right, wrong, or different from what, and again, you may have heard something different, but I listened to those, you know, teleconferences, and again, the impression I got from the representatives was they wanted to provide some sort of stability in terms of funding for the next couple of years until, you know, they could take a look at the school transform. So, you know, again, I've always said if you know and you can and you know what your funding is going to be, you know, you can better plan and you can commit to spending things. And if you don't know, you have to be afraid, you know, what might happen. And so, again, I think a stability in the school finance formula and funding would go a long ways in, and again, I don't think we'd have this discussion about, oh, a district's trying to carry over too much cash. And that, again, I think it's just prudent to protect yourselves when that funding source is so unreliable. So that's my opinion for what it's worth. So.
Any other questions for Mr. Byer?
Well, again, I appreciate being of service and look forward to working with you in the future. You've got my number. If anything comes up, Julianne's got my number and card. So.
All right. Okay. Thank you.
I'll get out of here and let you continue on with your meeting.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
President, I move the board to accept the 2013-14 financial audit as presented.
Second. Moved and seconded to accept the 2013-14 financial audit as presented. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carried, 7-0. Less purchases.
This has been a difficult situation to try to get a handle on with our bus situation. On page 26 of the supporting documents, you have our current fleet there. We run three routes, and last year we ran a Suburban on one of those routes. The route goes south. This year we've got a bus. It's a better situation to use a school bus. If we run a passenger vehicle, we have to pull into a driveway. We can't stop on the road. We also have to put kids in car seats, just like you would have to do with your own kids in the vehicle. So it's better to have the school bus in those situations. So we run the three routes. The buses would be number 3, number 8, and number 30. Those are our three route buses. Number 15 is a spare. I don't feel comfortable. It's kind of a shaky situation to take that to Wichita to get it inspected at the at the bus outfit there. So I don't feel confident with that one. And number 1 and number 2 are activity buses. The difficult thing with number 1, it's a smaller bus. The way those are listed, a 53-passenger, the way they list those is 3 kids to a seat. So it's really more like a 35-passenger. Maybe 17 seats and then a half seat or something like that. When we can't use bus number two, our big one, the big flat-nosed bus, for instance, we've had to use it here recently, bus number one is too small to take our track teams. So we have to end up taking a Suburban or two Suburbans just to get all the kids and equipment there. So really, we need two buses that are the size of our big bus number two. Currently, just the last week we learned the engine is blown in bus number two, our good bus. The block is cracked. That's going to cost $17,000 to fix. I've been in contact with the dealer about that, what warranty we have there. There is none. We're past that point. So we're without it here to finish out the year, and we're relying on bus number one, which, again, doesn't fit all of the kids. So really, what I would propose is to take bus number one and move it to one of the route buses. That would become one of our, you know, our bigger route bus. We'd replace number eight. Number eight would become a spare. We would purchase a new one to replace number one. It'd be very similar to that one, just bigger and with luggage racks. And then we would replace bus number three with a new bus of similar size, a 20-passenger. It's a smaller route bus. And bus number three would become a spare. On the proposal there, you see route. There's a mistake there. It should say bus number 30, not bus number three. Everybody see where I'm looking? Where it says proposal.
Oh, I love it.
It says proposal for 2015-16 bus fleet under the route. It says bus number three, the first one. That should be bus number 30.
Okay.
And then down below, our spares would be bus number three and bus number eight. Number 15, this should say 30. So those would be our three route buses. A new small one, similar to what we have. And then bus number one is our current activity bus, our smaller activity bus. And then bus number 30, we still use that one.
We have those three.
We'd add the new one here, this new activity bus. It looks just like what we have now. Our smaller activity bus would just be longer and have room for luggage. And we'd have our spares, and we'd probably get rid of number 15. We may keep it around just in case. But there's a cost to that. To the right there, what's up on the screen here, an activity bus, about $84,000, $85,000, and small route bus is $50,000. Now we've got options. Last meeting, recall, we briefly visited about maybe leasing buses. That would be our most expensive option. We just pay a lease and then turn it back in at the end of 3 years. And then move on from there and get a new one and keep doing that. That's our most expensive option. We could do a lease with a balloon option. For example, a small bus would be $56,000, $50,000. This is a different quote. A 3-year lease payment is $10,000. If you wanted a balloon payment at the end of that, it'd be $35,000. If we did a 6-year lease purchase, really the payment would be about the same. We'd pay on it longer, but we'd own the thing at the end. We wouldn't have that balloon payment. Third option would be just pay with cash. We have the cash in our capital outlay fund. I don't recommend taking that kind of cash out in 1 year. So I think our best option is to purchase those two buses, finance them for 6 years with that lease purchase. And
how's it going to cost more to lease a little bus than one that's a bigger bus? I'm talking $10,000 difference. I mean, got $10,000 6-year lease there for $60,000, the bus costs $50,000, and the other one's $84,000, and $15,000 would only be $90,000, so that's only $6,000, so you pay another $4,000 for a 6-year lease on a little bus.
This is the estimated numbers, I haven't run any hard numbers.
What's the average life of you, if we were to buy a new bus?
You can run them for 25 years,
legally,
according to Kansas law. Bus number 3 right now is a 2004 with 110,000 miles on it. It's about all used up, and we have a lot of trouble with it. Those washboard roads are pretty tough on those buses. So, you know, depending on what we're using it for, on some of those routes, 10 years is about all we want to be using now. Where we start dumping a bunch of money into them.
So under this proposal, we have about 4 years of use with a paid-off bus. Mm-hmm.
Now the activity bus, you'd have longer than that when you're running mostly highway miles and fewer miles. The paper I gave you is actual quoted price for the two buses. The one on the top row here, 71 passenger, that's the same size basically as our big activity bus now. Does not have air conditioning. Most of the year, we run the bus without the air conditioner running. You get a little bit of time in football season, a little bit of time in the spring, and that's it. So having one bus with air conditioning, I would recommend is good enough. And again, that one is basically the same as the one we have now. Bus number one, the activity bus, just bigger. And then the second one is a smaller bus. It says 29 passenger, but really that's more like 19. Short bus for just under 50,000. These buses here are bid on the state bid list, the Kansas Bus Purchasing Program. So to go with Bluebird buses, this is a pre-bid contract. We know we're getting the best price. So if we choose to do this, we don't have to go through the bid process. I can verify that these are, check with dealers to make sure we don't have cheaper buses out there. But this has been pre-bid and satisfied Kansas bid law. What we would need to do, if we would finance, how we could approve these purchases, we would need to obtain financing with our lease purchase agreement, similar to what we did for our building improvements that we did this summer, just not with all the legal publications and all that. We don't have to go through that since it's a smaller bank. But we would need to choose a lender. Both of our local banks do that. And we would need to make that, this board would need to make that decision how we move forward with that. This is a lot to process in one meeting. We got to get going on this to have them ordered and have them ready for next year.
So would a $25,000 payment fit in our budget coming up?
It would hurt a lot less than 1 year of paying for them.
Right. Paying for them just isn't.
No, it's not. It's just over $500,000 out of our capital outlay. If you want to think of it that way. The third option is we don't purchase anything, or we purchase one and we figure out how to make it work with the fleet we have. So.
So how many kids are out for track? You said an old wouldn't fit on the big bus.
Mm-hmm.
How many kids are there?
43, I think, in junior high. And 40 in high school. So they all fit on the big bus that we have, but not on the bus number one. That would get us with two full-size buses that, if we have things on the same at the same time, you know, we would avoid the situation where we're sending our track team in a bus and two Suburbans.
How often does that happen?
Well, with bus number two down, it's been every trip.
Well, yeah, it'd be every trip. Well, yeah. Yeah, until it gets fixed. Or,
yeah.
What happened to the engine?
I don't know.
How many miles on that?
Just over 50,000.
What those engines last? Engines lasted forever, Tom.
The diesel, I'm surprised that you never heard
that. Is that the one that was sitting up at Hudson?
Yeah, it was. Yeah. Yeah.
What happened to discover that we had to?
There was an engine warning light, and engine stop, and engine oil was over full.
Yeah, here's the short stop.
That was,
that was
key indicator
came on. Yeah, it was.
Yeah, they took it to high school track meet, and it was, as soon as it got out of town, it came on and turned around. Yeah, it was water in the oil. The block is cracked.
So we don't buy extended warranties on anything, or would that have worked with that?
I don't know if they offer that or not.
On buses?
And we don't just use these buses for extracurricular activities. We use them for field trips too.
How are you doing the field trips? This is field trip season.
Yeah, same thing. If we can't fit them all in bus one, we have to take another vehicle. We're doing that this week. Yeah,
Wednesday.
I think it's pretty important to keep everything up in shape. Otherwise, you run into repairs cost you money, get stranded alongside the road. I mean, you don't want those scenarios.
Do you think we'd have to replace anything else in the next few years?
Now we're getting close on number 30, yeah. And actually, number 30 is older than, number 3, but it's in better shape. It's a tough little bus.
I mean, number 30 is, 16 years old?
Mm-hmm. You put together a fleet replacement plan? Mm-hmm. Does this fit into that?
It does not. No, this is accelerated the replacement of buses.
And 15 needs to be disposed of, but you're contemplating keeping it.
Yeah. It'll run a route. Make that work. I hate to keep buses around if we're not going to use them, because if it sits all year and then we need it, then it may not start.
If they sit, they crack.
Yeah. There's not a great answer here. So
is it accelerated because the other one's down, or is it just?
No, not just that. I mean, that's really brought this whole activity issue to light. We discussed it before about having a smaller activity bus. It's almost not worth having because we can't take our. And we end up with a situation like this. And again, some of that is because of the number two being down. But,
so
if we bought the big bus, where would that put us without having the small bus? What would that do to it?
I would recommend, if we're only going to do one, I would recommend buying the smaller route bus.
Okay.
If we're going to do that. If we can only do one, I would recommend the smaller route bus. We'll make do with the activities. But we either need to replace, you know, really number 8 is on its last leg on that engine. And it's to the point where we need to decide whether we dump money into that and keep it running. Or,
is there any financial incentive to buying 2 at one time?
No.
Does that matter?
No. And again, I know this is a lot to swallow and contemplate, so I really think we need to move on this before June. So if we're not comfortable making a decision tonight, I would recommend we have a quick special meeting here in the next couple of weeks to get going on this.
Can you refresh us on what your proposed bus plan was before it was accelerated?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I did not have any bus down to be replaced until 2018-2019.
That's a ways away.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, these dollars, just a rough estimate, dollars in repairs this year besides that one engine.
Oh, I'd 20,000.
And that bus?
No, all of them.
Oh.
That would probably include our passenger vehicles as well, and tires and oil changes and those things. Yeah, we take them to our buses to Wichita, and they go through them, fix any issues, get them ready for inspection. Running these older buses would be a lot easier if we had a mechanic on hand. You know, if we had our own mechanic, some districts do. We don't have that.
Would Mr. Alton mechanic? Did he do that in the third time?
Triple the cost you're talking about. Working on.
Yeah.
Do we not have anybody in the community or Stafford County that would be certified to do that?
Well, I mean, we have local mechanics that work on the buses, but you know, to have somebody looking at them every day and tending to every issue, that's a little different.
I mean, the reason you send it to Wichita is because it's...
We send it to Wichita once a year because they're a bus dealer and you know, they have the parts.
All the
and
inspections.
The inspections are a bigger deal on the big buses. But we don't send our, you know, Fisher's does our... passenger vehicles, they can do those, but...
Well, what little I know at the moment, you know, we've got by with the one big bus for 10 years anyway, and it's got the engine problem. You fix it, you're just in a bind until you get it fixed. You know, I guess getting the small route bus, I'd be in favor of that, but I don't see, with our numbers being down so much, looking forward possibly in junior high and everything, that it's going to be that big of an issue. And if you needed a Suburban or something to take part of the people, you got plenty of coaches that are going and driving, and we got plenty of vehicles for that. A little problem short term, you just deal with it.
Yeah, and let me clarify my thinking on the why we would buy a bigger activity bus. Rather than buying a large route bus to replace number 8, we would buy it, you know, spend basically the same amount of money, you know, maybe spend a little more on a large activity bus and move that number 1 activity bus into our route service. So it's not just
that we need the activity bus. I agree with you, we can get by with bus number one and bus number two with our activities. But if we're going to put that kind of money into a large bus, we might as well get our activity buses in line where we want them and rotate that number one activity bus into the route fleet.
She just said if you want to buy one bus, we need to buy a little bus instead of a big bus.
Yeah, that's correct.
That's what
yes.
I thought.
Yeah.
So the small route bus is a what passenger bus then? Is it this 30?
About 20. We can make the small bus work in any one of those routes. A small route bus can replace the large route bus right now. But we need a larger route bus if we want to do one route. And we have two small buses, we can't combine those into one route,
okay.
Ever. You know, so we have to have one larger route bus, even if it's,
so if
we get by with the small one.
If you go into one route, now, is there a amount of time that it hit, or is there a recommended time that they're not to run?
There's no legal time. We try to keep it to an hour or less from,
and so we
to get here at 7:30, but...
There's
one route that's a little longer than that.
Yeah, we've run numbers to where we could combine a route?
Not right now. It would be way too long.
Okay.
It would be probably over an hour and a half.
Looking down the road where kids live, that's a possibility?
Could be, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. What I'm not comfortable doing is just having three small route buses. You know, long term, having a larger route bus, and there may be times where you know one is down, or we have a you know kids are gone on a field trip, and we do just take one route. So I would feel much more comfortable having a large route bus in our route fleet.
But if we bought a smaller bus, you said it would work for any of our routes right now.
Mm-hmm. It would.
So you could save like bus number one and use the new bus for a route bus right now.
Yeah. So we can get by just fine if we've just bought a small route bus. Bus number eight and bus number three. Bus number eight for sure needs to not be a route bus anymore. That's our situation right now. Bus number eight is our priority. If we replace that with a small route bus, we can get by.
Sounds like we're down to deciding if we want another big bus.
I think we'll just go with the small bus this year. I mean, you don't know what money's going to be here in another year either.
Right.
So, I mean, you don't want to commit too much at one time.
Right.
No, and that's why I would not recommend taking all of the money out of capital outlay right now. I believe we need to finance it. I hate being in that situation.
I think we're having the two bigger buses. They only got 46,000 and 48,000 miles on them.
Well,
that's a
while.
We
only have one large bus.
No, there's two.
No, there's one large bus. Number two is the only large bus that we have.
Number one's big, just not that big.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's just an odd size. It's not big enough for the activities, but it's too big for some routes.
Yeah, and it's not really even too big for some routes. I mean, if we had it in our fleet, it would be just like we're using number eight.
Yeah, it's just not big enough to carry everyone to an activity.
Right.
But it carries everybody, like in basketball or football or volleyball, to an activity, but just not track.
No, even basketball, when you get, you know, if you got, I don't know the numbers, but.
Well.
Anyway, it's close.
You're at this 35. talking about putting an expensive bus on a road that you're gonna total the bus in 10 years. Mm-hmm. That's kind of hard to put an expensive vehicle on there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're. I mean, we can get cheaper ones.
Well, they'll fall apart sooner too.
I understand what you're saying, but they really don't have a choice.
No.
That's been that way before, and it's gonna be that way in the future.
Yeah.
If we bought a small bus, you would move it to the number one place, and the number one would go to the number eight place. Is that correct?
If we bought a small route bus, it would just replace number eight, the large route bus.
But it's a spare right now, so
no, number eight.
15 is a spare.
Oh, yeah. So
it would move to a spare.
Yeah. How do you get rid of that?
Speaking. Number eight here is our current route bus.
Okay. Well, I was looking at the proposal.
Okay. I feel comfortable just getting the little one tonight, and you know, everybody can think on it, and if we need to, we can come back and get the other one where there's no incentive to order them both at the same time.
Well, this price that you have here is ordering it now, right? Mm-hmm. Later on, you're not going to guarantee that.
Right, they would rebid those. But
would it be slower? No. But probably not. It's going to be in demand.
So if what I'm hearing most, replacing the small bus, replacing one of the route buses with a new small bus, what the board would like to do now.
We could always revisit this next year.
Yeah. It's not, we can make it work.
Mm-hmm. I just think we're going to be cut more money.
We'll have two buses that need repair, the engine and then bus eight. Mm-hmm. But eight would go to the spare, we get rid of 50.
Bus 8 right now for 2 years has been blowing oil by, and it's this year it's been just a matter of getting it to the end of the year and then we'll decide whether we want to rebuild that engine or it's not even worth doing that. You rebuild an engine for $12,000 and bus 8. Bus it's worth $5,000.
And it's got $123,000 on the bag of dollars. Since the time. Yeah.
Well, bus 15, that way. I mean, you've also got $143,000.
It's not real reliable, but I think the engine is just fine. We would need to take action on this to purchase it. The second thing we need to do is the financing. We need to make a decision about that. I can go through the vendor. They have their financing company that they work with. We can use local vendors. Currently, we're using SJM Bank of Kansas for our capital lease agreement right now.
I'm trying to get local if we can.
Are we ready to formalize this, or is there any more discussion? As far as the purchase of the small bus.
The motion would then be cost not to exceed $49,000. Just make it $50,000 and that would cover it in the bid.
Mr. President, I move the board approve purchase of a new small bus not exceed $50,000 from the Kansas Bus Purchasing Program.
Second.
So moved and seconded to approve the purchase of a new small bus not to exceed $50,000 from the Kansas Bus Purchasing Program. Is there any discussion? Not all in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carried, 7-0.
I'll get back with you on the financing situation. We need to take action on that at some point. So.
Do
June meeting?
Quicker if we can. If they can hold off on, you know, if they can hold the bus for us, we'll just do it at the June meeting. If they can't, we need to move quicker.
It's already built.
It's built. It's on their lot, so I will look at it before I commit to it.
And that'll be a gas loan?
Yes. Yes. That will be very helpful.
It's very helpful.
Our bus drivers, you know, getting out at 5:30 in the morning to start them. Sometimes it's trouble with those diesel engines.
All right. Next item, weight room. Part of our tour here before the main part of our meeting.
You've had information about this for some time. We discussed it last meeting.
Do you want to go through any steel before we discuss?
You know, I think the costs are minimal to do it. You know, we'll use our own local, you know, our own labor to move things and get the kids to help out to move some things.
That's my good thought.
You know, the downside is we're taking classroom space. I think it's space we can still have what we offer the kids right now, not change that. I think we can definitely do that. So, my recommendation is to move ahead with this and relocate the weight room this summer.
Any thoughts closing that?
Mr. Bergen, as far as the classes that we have down there, any thoughts on what we might be losing out on?
Yeah, we the part-time, you know, thing on Mr. Moore, we have to, when we use the shop, we can still use the shop area. He would use his classroom and still be able to use the wood shop or the metal shop. Yeah. With the classes, depending on when we're doing welding or a woods class, so we'd still be able to do that. We just have one classroom, so, but we'd still be able to use both the shop areas, obviously, and offer those classes. Yeah. Just not sure exactly what order or how we do that yet next year, but we haven't gone through all the classes and all the pre-enrollment information yet. Yeah. Get a better idea what kids want classes and what fits in their schedule.
Any further questions?
I know what's going to happen when kids are in the weight room and Mr. Miller's got a class over there and they got their music blaring because they like to listen.
We won't be able to turn. I mean, if it's a problem, you know, if they can hear the music, if it's becoming a problem, they'd have to turn it off.
Yeah. It's yeah. Could be it's, supervised.
Yeah. Yeah.
Sounds like you're using money better places than doing this with this market.
I was invited in last fall to the weight room on one of those blistering days, and it was like being inside of a grain bin.
That's not a good place to be.
No.
No.
So I'm all for moving, just for the well-being of the kids.
I'm ready unless someone has anything else to say.
Mr. President, I move the board approve the relocation of the weight room to the main building.
Second. Move and seconded to approve the relocation of the weight room to the main building. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay.
Nay.
Motion carried 6-1. 2015-16 fee schedule.
The fee schedule is on page 28. I included on this the sports participation fee and then crossed it off. So I had it on there for purposes of discussion. it's come up in, with this group, and a bit, people have asked about it to help out the budget. Why don't we have a pay-to-play situation? If we did that, my recommendation would be to have $25 per sport. You cap it at $50 for each kid. So if your kid went out for three sports, it'd just be $50. If you got three kids and each of them is $50, you're still only going to pay $100. So we cap it at $100 for the family. We had a pretty good discussion at our site council meeting. The consensus was, you know, if it's going to discourage even one kid from participating, we don't want to see that happen. One of the site council members caught me after the meeting and said, I think we should do it. I didn't feel comfortable saying that in the meeting. So there may be other opinions like that as well. But if you think of it this way, if we had 100 kids, each one of them paying $50, that'd be about $5,000. That's a lot more than zero into our budget. Think about this way, that $5,000 is 0.1 mils in our budget, $1.30 on a $100,000 home. So one comment was that the fees are very regressive. We should not have as many. So I'm not recommending a sports participation fee at this time. Real quick, the other thing on there is the lunch fees. Those aren't set. We're required to raise those or have them at a certain level compared to what they pay for a free lunch. So we don't have that guidance yet. The maximum increase would be 10 cents. And then along those lines on the lunch and breakfast fees, I've included on the next page.
Why is the state aid down from the 2012-13?
I don't know the answer to that.
You know, almost $2,000.
I can't answer that right now.
I was just wondering if I saw that.
What percent of the public is paying for the lunch?
We're at district-wide, about 60% of our students qualify for free or reduced price lunches.
So if you raise its cost for lunch, only 40% of them would cover it.
Yeah. So this spreadsheet here shows you that we supplement, last year, about $18,000 from our general fund for our food service program. Which really, we do pretty good from what I've compared to other districts. So when people say, why is the lunch so expensive, it's still not enough to make it, have us break even. And then page 30 shows a comparison of different fees in Kansas school districts. So I did include the sports fee there. It's hard to compare this because some of them have maybe just a fee for the whole year. Or maybe they have a fee for each sport. So it may vary, but that shows you kind of comparing 77 districts in our state do this and have reported it, and those are the ranges. All these other fees shows what different districts collect fees for to help out with their budget. We don't do a lot of those. Textbook fee, you can see we're a little bit above average for high school. Ours is in the blue there on the bottom. Middle school, we're a little bit more above average. Same thing with elementary. Driver's ed, that's a fee we just passed recently. We just decided to do that. We had to do that one ahead of time. So we're on the low end there. That all day kindergarten, some districts charge for all day kindergarten. $2,700 in one district.
Is our overall enrollment fee, is it somewhere on here? Compared to other districts?
The textbook fee is what we're looking at when you come and enroll. The textbook fee, the high school textbook, middle school textbook. Ours is $55.
So we're right.
$50.
Right in the median for enrollment, basically.
Yeah. Yeah. And then the lunch prices is on the bottom there. So, and actually we're, you know, really on the high end there already, our lunch prices. So even though we supplement a little bit, we're gonna, if we don't have to increase that 10 cents, we won't quite go up to that likely, but we'll have to do that the next year. So that's all of the fees there. Nothing, I don't recommend any changes. So the one question mark, I guess, would be the sports fee.
It seems how we had trouble fielding you know, some teams. I don't see how a fee would help that situation. When we're letting sixth graders play now. That's just my thought.
Somebody mentioned if there was a fee and kids can't pay, people in the community would step up and help out.
Well, I'm sure they would, but they're stepping up in other ways.
Right.
Already.
So my recommendation is to approve the fee schedule. And again, just to clarify, the sports participation fee and cross that, I would include that.
Mr. President, I move the board approve the 2015-16 fee schedule as presented.
Second.
Moved and seconded to approve the 2015-16 fee schedule as presented. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carried, 7-0. 2015-16 student handbook.
The handbook is included as a separate document. Mr. Olive, Mr. Berg, and I spent considerable time going through to consolidate our handbooks. It's kind of difficult. We have to make sure our handbook matches our board policy. There's things that cross over there. And having two different handbooks makes that a little more difficult. We just have one place where we update things. That'll help us be more consistent. You know, a lot of the things are the same anyway. You know, the grading scale is district-wide. Things like that. So. It is important that to know this is board policy. Once we approve this, this is our board policy. So it's not just those guys over there take it and run with it, and this is how we outline our expectations. So I feel comfortable with where we're at and the work that these guys went through to get there. I recommend it, approving it as presented. Can we take a motion?
Mr. President, I move the board approve the handbook as presented.
Second.
I'm sorry, I didn't. Did you guys have anything to add?
No, I think it went. We did. We tried to note in there when there was something that only applied to the high school or only applied to the elementary.
Yeah, actually, it worked out pretty well. I wasn't sure how that would work out to get it all put in one thing, but I think it worked out all right.
Yeah.
So you're.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. Sorry. Mm-hmm. So moved second to approve the 2015-16 student handbook as presented. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carried. 7-0. KASB dues and legal assistance fund.
We're a member of the Association of School Boards of Kansas. I recommend we continue that. There's information on your supporting documents about what we get for that on page 32. I highlighted some things, what we get for that. I communicate with their legal staff frequently. You know, anytime I have a question about prayer at the athletic banquet or things like that, that I need some legal advice on, and we call them. These guys can call on them. We have a difficult custody issue that we have to deal with. It's nice to be able to call them. The separate document is this adoption agreement. Just says it's more specific about the legal assistance fund. Just wanted to make sure that we all know that's what we're approving, so. It's KSB adoption agreement, that's what that is. So Chad will have to sign this. Recommend we approve those two things.
So you think it's well worth the money?
I do, absolutely.
Did have them dues change since last year?
No, same as last year. Both the legal assistance fee and dues are the same as last year.
Mr. President, I move the board approve the dues for $4,933 for the 2015-16 membership in the AASB and the fee of $1,650 for the legal assistance fund.
Is there a second?
Second.
So moved and seconded that the board approve the dues of $4,933 for the 2015-16 membership in KASB and the fee of $1,650 for the legal assistance fund. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carried.
President Fisher?
Yes.
I did not hear who did the second.
Bill.
Thank you.
Junior high football.
I had this on here as an action item until last week, and we've got nine kids that have said they're going to play football. The league would prefer, Mr. Bergen's checked with all the league schools, even if we have to play six man, they'd prefer to do that than have us wearing red jerseys and lose out on a game. So even if all nine don't come out, if we have some,
I think it helped the volleyball situation too.
Yeah, the volleyball would be tricky if we were co-op. So I told them, so there's no action on this. I just want to make sure we know what's happening here. The plan would be to have Zach Mason, he was our assistant coach last year, do that on his own, as a single coach. I think he can handle that. Coach, they'll have high school coaches out there at practice, and an administrator will be there at games. If something is needed there. So, if we by chance find somebody who's willing to help out, we'll do that, but it'll save a little money too.
And there definitely needs to be an administrator there. I think it makes a tough situation if a kid gets hurt.
I agree. There needs to be two people there. Yes.
I agree. Okay. Anything else on that? Guidelines for sixth grade athletics.
We discussed this. Also, this is just on page 35, this is just guidelines from the Board of Education to administrators. This is kind of what we expect. In general, we would like sixth graders to be able to participate. It gets them, there's more opportunity for kids to participate, and that's a good thing. What we don't want to get into is we have too many kids where it's going to require extra transportation or additional coaches. Or it's taking away from 7th and 8th graders, taking away from their experience. If we have 30 kids on the basketball team, there's only so many minutes in a ball game, we can't get them all in. So, let's just look at basketball. Really, we need 10 kids to make a decent team for JV games. It'd be better if we had 12, but we could make it work with 10, provided they would all stay out. So if we have, this spring we sign the kids up, if we have 13 kids or more that say they're going to play basketball, that's probably good enough. Now, these are guidelines, so if you have 2 sixth graders that want to play and it's going to make it 15, there would be some leeway to allow that if the board is comfortable with that. If there's 13 seventh and eighth graders, but there's 10 sixth graders that want to play, we may not want to consider allowing them to play because then we get above that maximum team size. Now, to clarify too, that maximum team size isn't, we would stop it at that level. You know, we're gonna let sixth graders play in a particular sport, or we're not. If it makes 21, then we're a little above where we want to be. We're not gonna cut kids. What's that?
If there's more seventh and eighth graders than 20 or so.
Right, yeah, we're not gonna cut. And even if it's, we decide to allow sixth graders, we're not gonna only allow five sixth graders. We either allow them to play or we don't. And this will allow, so we don't have to come to the board before every season. Kids kind of know ahead of time. We can get the sign-ups and they participate in the summer things if they need to. Does that kind of make sense how it's laid out?
So can 45 kids fit on our bus on the track thing? Or do we need to lower that to 43?
We can put three in a seat of the little one. There are some junior high kids. We can use the three bottoms in one of those seats.
We got luggage.
Throw on top.
Any questions about that proposal?
Mr. President, I move the board approve the guidelines for sixth grade athletic participation.
Second motion.
So moved and seconded to approve the guidelines for the sixth grade athletic participation. All in favor, aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carried, 7-0. Communications, board member activities and reports.
Carl?
I don't have any this time.
Yep. Paul?
Barb?
I helped with AR store, that was interesting.
I've been to several track meets at St. John, and nobody runs them better than the people at St. John.
Even the elementary.
Yep.
I agree. Sam?
No.
Attended the special ed co-op meeting. As I mentioned earlier, the head of the co-op's resigning this summer. We're looking at an internal candidate, very nice, qualified lady, basically second in charge right now. So we'll be voting on that at the next meeting coming up. So that's the big news. There's lots of other, but anyways,
numbers haven't changed. Nobody in, nobody out. I had this on last month, and I forgot to bring it up for some reason. But Deb Esau from Instructional Design Solutions presented me, really presented our school with this plaque. It says this achievement award is presented to St. John Elementary School for outstanding Kansas reading initiative results. I'll pass that around. Last year we applied for the governor's reading initiative to get Lexia supplied to our school through a grant. And they track our data, how kids are progressing, making sure that kids are using it the amount that they're required to based on what their needs are in reading and whatnot. And our kids made significant enough gains within that program with their reading and writing skills to earn that award. So that's kind of neat to get recognition for that. Elementary track meet was last Friday, had a nice day for it. It was, you know, kind of overcast and not too hot, not too cold. Went smoothly, avoided the rain, was done early, everything. Thought everything went well. Preschool and kindergarten, they have a little graduation ceremony next Monday. Preschool have a morning and an afternoon one. Kindergarten will do theirs at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. Students' last day is next Tuesday at 11 o'clock. They'll be dismissed. And then just kind of winding things down. Staff's last day will be next Wednesday. They'll do their checkout for the summer and some of that stuff. And then myself, Mr. Bergen, and Mr. Meyer will be attending the USA. Mine would be the KESP Summer Conference, June 3rd through 5th. That's in Wichita, so that will be coming up shortly. That's all I've got.
Thank you.
Yep. Mr. Kirby.
I think enrollment number, I think those are actually, we've had a couple go in and out, but they're exactly the same. I think when we started, you can see by grade and the ones that are at the learning center. Oh, I mentioned about, I think I mentioned last month, that we had some students that qualified for state music, and I put their names in here, Brooke Schultz, Bella Martinez Haskins, and Taylor Clark, and what they received at state. So that was pretty, pretty good, pretty impressive. Last Tuesday night, Mr. Knight, the high school band and high school vocal, had a concert in the auditorium. That was quite entertaining. If you were, there to, well, Tom was, if you were there to watch. Yeah, it's quite entertaining. good job. Honors luncheon, we did that. We held that in the courtyard last Wednesday for the kids. National Honor Society kids helped put that together, and then all the kids on the AV honor roll. And the rain held off for that too, so that worked out well. CPL art contest was last month, and I put down here the students. My back, I don't have a lot of, as far as explaining what all that means. I'm just letting you know that that's what Mrs. Binky told me, and she knows exactly what that means. So I didn't pretend to know. I just know that that's how, what she told me that I did. So I wanted to make sure they were recognized for the kids at the CPL contest at Otis Bison. We had, on the 27th, we recognized junior high kids at the Booster Club banquet for the activities this year. Nice evening. Adjusting class schedule for next year and pre-enrollment numbers, going over those currently. High school activities banquet, Booster Club banquet is tomorrow evening, 6:30. Some of you, all of you will be there, all invited. Recognize all the things we, our high school kids have done this year. Baccalaureate is Wednesday evening at 7 o'clock. Class night is Friday evening at 7 o'clock. CPL track is tomorrow at 10 o'clock in the morning at Lacrosse, hosted by Otis Bison. Hopefully that's soon enough that they'll be done a certain amount of time so some can make it back for the high school banquet. That won't be like that next May. Next year, the schedule will be, not everything will be crowded up like that. High school track meet is at Ellenwood on Thursday, starting at 3 o'clock. We host 2A regional golf, one of the 2As, and that will be at our prestigious Stafford County Country Club next Monday. Starting at shotgun start, starting at 9 o'clock, there will be, I don't know, 72, 73 kids out there playing golf. So if you drive by, you might make a wide loop, so that will hit your windshield. Regional track is on the 22nd at Greensburg at 3 o'clock. I put an administrative student activity account and graduation Saturday at 4 o'clock. I think everybody, like we did graduation, we will, last year we set the stage up and then the kids sat right in front. We all sat on the stage, toward the back part of the stage, and then the kids all came in on the north side, walked across, and you guys worked that out as far as, you know, Chad and Barb and whoever wants to be up there. You know, we had, if your son or daughter was coming across like last year when Carl had a son or daughter, and we'll go over that a little bit when we meet in the teacher's lounge there before we go in the gym. I'll go over there for anything, any questions you have or any last minute things. So we'll have it all set up because we'll have practice, graduation practice on Friday at 2:30 with the kids. So other than that, everything should be set up like it was. And if you have any questions during the week of leading up to that, please holler at me or email me or call me or whatever, come by. If anything, you get any questions about anything for graduation. So we should all be, hopefully they all make it to practice on Friday. So anyway, that's all I had. So, questions or anything?
So on our graduation, we'll be there.
Right.
In the lounge.
In the lounge, yeah, you can be there. Yeah, if you're there at 3:20 or 3:40, 3:45, that's fine. Yeah, we don't have to be there. You know, kind of just a couple minutes. We'll make sure everybody's. We go in. We'll go in the north doors on the north side there. We'll go through that real quick, and it won't be a problem. So, okay. Thank you,
Mr. Mark.
Career and college readiness, I wanted to update a few things there. Actually, the best way, I need to talk about this, I have to share this video. Recall that Lisa's done a lot of work with this, Lisa Cornwell, with our internships and externships, I guess is technically what they're called, but, and our CTE courses and the college courses and a lot of those things. So she's put together this video here on what some of the kids have done through the course of this.
This is the 350 Career and College Ready. Over the past 2 years, students at St. John High School have earned over 250 college credit hours. All students, your seniors, have the opportunity to take the WorkKeys test for work-ready certifications. We've received grant money the past 2 years to provide this opportunity. Six seniors will graduate with their certified nurse aide certificate. One senior has over 135 hospital clinical hours in phlebotomy and is qualified to set for national phlebotomy certification. Students worked at the city office, Kenwood Plaza, Kansas Co-op, Stafford County Extension Council, and Fisher Auto Service during the school age. Here are a few students who have completed college credit hours.
I'm Ashlyn Fisher, and I'm planning on being an anesthesiologist and going to K-State in the fall to major in chemistry and biology. And while in high school, I got 23 credit hours.
I'm Audrey Berthier, I'm a junior, and I have 9 hours of college credit.
Christie, and I plan to go to Kansas State University and major in ag finance. I have 3 hours of college credit and have spent approximately 270 hours at the city office. There I have entered city payments, filed papers, subtracted meter posts, helped in getting the Jubilee ready, answered the phone, and helped people up front.
I'm Javon Valenzuela, and I'm planning to go to WSU, which is a state university, and I'm planning to be a dental hygienist. In high school, I took 6 credit hours and I worked at the extension office doing some filing and office work.
I'm Bella, and I am a junior. I have 3 college hours.
I am Junior Titus. I plan to go to BART and finish my automotive certificate. I will have 12 hours of college credit when I graduate. I worked at the co-op for a semester and I learned how to do a complete tire change. I use a lift and all about different types of oil for your car engine.
Hello, I'm Sam Ramirez. I am a sophomore and I have 3 college credit hours. I'm Austin Towers. I'm a junior and I have 6 credit hours.
My name is Heather Claros. I plan to go to Pratt Community College and major in athletic training. I'm graduating with 3 college credit hours.
I'm Patrick Dorn. I'm a sophomore and I have 3 hours of college credit.
I'm Ariana Trimmert. I'm a senior in high school going to Pratt Community College, and I'm graduating with 5 credit hours because I got my CNA. I'm a certified nurse today.
I'm Cody Hoverman. I attend St. John High School. I'm going to be going to Washburn University. I have 6 college credits, and I'm going to major in computer science.
I'm Elizabeth Ramirez. I'm a sophomore.
I'm Felica McCall. I'm a senior at St. John, and I have 15 college credits.
I'm Brianna Towers, and I'm taking 47 credit hours of college courses. I have gotten my CPA and CMA during high school, and I plan to go to Barton County and get my RN and then go get my anesthesiologist.
My name is Tyler Dove. I'm a certified nurse aide. I have 11 college credit hours. I plan to go to Barton Community College to be a medical lab technician.
I'm Nathan Ward. I'm a junior. I have 3 college credit hours.
3 doesn't necessarily translate into a higher salary. 43% of people with licenses and certificates receive more earnings than a people with an associate degree. 27% of people with licenses and certificates have higher salaries than people with bachelor's degrees.
31% of people with associate degrees have higher salaries than people with bachelor's.
College and career ready goals for 2015-16. All students will have an individual learning plan in place. Parents will be given information on student learning plans at conferences. Teachers will take active role in student learning plans at conferences. College classes will be available for juniors and seniors. Students interested will be encouraged to obtain job skills, certificates, and participate in externships.
So that's kind of some of those things in a nutshell. Giving kids more opportunities. Not all of those are, you know, things that we have done. You know, kids still get college credits on their own, doing some neat things there. Any questions about anything we've got going on there? Teacher appreciation lunch we had Thursday. We grilled some hamburgers and hot dogs out in the library courtyard area for staff. It's kind of a nice, relaxing time to enjoy the nice day. New board member workshop. I had two board members go to that. And I got some pretty good information. I'm not going to read this to you, but I'll pass it around here. You can take one. Maybe good reminders for board members, just some things about what our roles are as a board, what powers do we have. Some things about meetings, so just some two-page deal about some good information for the new board members. Still good information.
Yeah, you still have some meetings to go to.
One. So that went well. Vehicles, we had them adjusted from the hailstorm, about $18,000 worth of damage to our vehicles that we'll need to get fixed this summer.
Bus.
What's that?
Said enough to pay for a bus.
No, we have to get the vehicles fixed to use the money. But,
what about the roof? Any thoughts there?
You know, our roof, we'll have our consultant come in here when we get to summer. We haven't had any. You know, the one that concerns me the most is the library with that rubber. But for the most part, we have rock on everything, which really protects that from hail damage. I was impressed with the sturdiness of our skylights. I was a little concerned with that. But those are all fine. So, health insurance, I think I mentioned this in one of the Friday notes, but we're looking at about a 4% increase, $20 a month. If we cover all of that for the employees, which is what we've traditionally done, about $12,500 increased cost for next year, which is not out of line at all. Budget. I don't have the foggiest idea what to tell you about this right now, to be honest with you. I could pretend like I do. I don't. I feel good about our situation here with the court case coming and with what the legislature is going to do with the taxes. I don't know. The court case really throws a wrench into everything. They may come in and say the block grant is not constitutional, figure something else out. And worst case scenario, they say you can't fund the schools. You're forbidden from putting any money in the schools, and they shut down. And, I don't think it will get to that. We'll have a lot of upset patrons. But so I don't have anything more firm on that to tell you right now. So until that's finalized, we really can't move ahead with our negotiations. So that is also on hold for now.
I'm ready to go.
Yeah.
Who's this?
Who's Tom?
Tom.
The insurance package, I met with our insurance agent. They got some information finalized. Recall we're using local agent, same insurance company more than likely. Hopefully we won't see huge increases there. I think property insurance should be fairly flat. But we'll have that for the next meeting. The fire alarm, last meeting the board approved the last phase of that. The fire marshal has approved us to do it in two more phases. So we'll do half of it this summer, which will help with the bottom line, and then the rest of it the following summer. So they're on board to do that. That also allows us to lock in that pricing for these 2 years. That'll also help. The track, we're supposed to know by the end of April whether we got the grant or not, but we still don't know. I don't, the Secretary of State, it's on his desk to sign off on those grants, and it's still there. So why there's the holdup, I don't know. But so I will update you further on that when I know more. That's all.
Okay.
Head for my report.
Thank you, Mr. Meyer. Executive session, who are you in there?
The two principals I think they're. Might just be 10 minutes unless.
10 minutes?
All right.
Mr. President, I move the board go into executive session to discuss personnel matters in order to protect the privacy of the non-elected personnel with Mr. Olive and Mr. Durbin. Mr. Meyer to be included, that we return to open session in 10 minutes in this room.
Second. Move and second to go into executive session to discuss personnel matters in order to protect the privacy of non-elected personnel with Mr. Durbin, Mr. Olive, and Mr. Meyer to be included. And that we return to open session in 10 minutes. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, nay. Motion carried, 7-0.
Board approve the supplemental contract list they presented.
Second that.
Moved and seconded to approve the supplemental contracts list as presented. All in favor, aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carried, 7-0. We have a retirement letter from Joel Miller.
Mr. President, I move the board approve the retirement letter from Joel Miller.
Second.
Moved and seconded to approve the retirement letter from Joel Miller. All in favor, aye.
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 Opposed, nay. Motion carried, 7-0. Future agenda items are there in front of you. Anything to add, Mr. Meyer?
No, I don't. I've got a negotiated agreement on there. I don't anticipate we'll be done with that by the June meeting. The goal would be to do that, but I don't think so. Same thing will go for pay raises. I'll try to get them.
Okay. If there's nothing else, motion for adjournment.
Mr. President,
we adjourn.
Second.
Second, we adjourn. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carried. 7-0.
Yeah.
Thank you.